All right, thank you, ladies. Galatians chapter 6 this morning. Galatians chapter number 6. We are finished with our minor prophets. We're going to go to Galatians 6. All right, our junior church folks, you can walk to the back. Miss Rachel is going to take care of that this morning. So Galatians chapter 6 for everybody else. Junior church folks, if you're elementary, 6th grade and under, you can be dismissed to walk to the back and have fun in junior church here today. Y'all make sure y'all get them all. If there's any adults that would like to go. Galatians chapter number 6. All right, before we read, I have some familiar hymns or favorite hymns of certain occupations that I wanted to share with you this morning that will lead us into what we're going to actually speak about today when I survey the wondrous cross. We mentioned some of these in the 9:30 service, but I'll mention them again. The dentist's favorite hymn is "Crown Him with Many Crowns." Did y'all know that? The weatherman's favorite hymn is "There Shall Be Showers of Blessing." The contractor's favorite hymn is "The Church's One Foundation." The politician's favorite hymn, "Standing on the Promises." A little shaky there, though. The optometrist hymn, "Open My Eyes." The gossip's favorite hymn, "Pass It On." The realtor's favorite hymn, "I Got a Mansion Over the Hilltop." And the pilot's favorite hymn is "I'll Fly Away." Now, the architect's favorite hymn is "How Firm a Foundation." The zookeeper has a favorite hymn. You know what it is? "All Creatures of Our God and King." The postal worker's favorite hymn, "So Send I You." The lifeguard's favorite hymn, "Rescue the Perishing." The travel agent's favorite hymn, "Anywhere with Jesus." The librarian's favorite hymn, "Whispering Hope." And the geologist's favorite hymn, "Rock of Ages." And then the surveyor's favorite hymn is "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross," which is what we want to speak about this morning. In 1707, Isaac Watts was thinking about the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ and what it meant to him. And he wrote these words that we still sing today, which we sang earlier. "When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss and pour contempt on all my pride." Then he, in verse number 3, says, "See from his head, his hands, his feet, sorrow and love flow mingle down. Did e'er such love and sorrow meet, or thorns compose so rich a crown?" And then he got to thinking about again the response that he should have to this wondrous cross. And he said, "Were the whole realm of nature mine," think about that, if you owned all the realm of nature, "were the whole realm of nature mine, that were a present far too small. Love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all." Now this morning, the cross means different things to different people. And so I ask you, what does the cross of Christ mean to you when you survey the wondrous cross, when you survey the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ, when you stand back and you look at what happened there on that cross when Jesus hung there? What does that mean to you? What does that say to you? How does that speak to you? Think about that this morning. To Paul, he said this in verse 14 of Galatians chapter 6. "But God forbid that I should glory, save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. God forbid that I should glory, except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ." Now, what do you think about when you see a cross? And again, what does the cross of Christ mean to you? I'll tell you this morning that we have lost much of the horror that is associated with a cross. especially here, in the 21st century, the idea of a cross is a beautiful thing. But I'll tell you, in the first century A.D., a cross was anything but beautiful. The cross was associated with blood and pools of fresh blood, pools of sweat and tears and cries of excruciating agony, and it was associated with death and rotting flesh. The hill that Jesus Christ was crucified on is called Golgotha, or the place of a skull. Many people said it looked like a skull, but I'll tell you this much, it could very well be called the place of a skull because of all the skulls that were there. After people died and were just left, some out into the open, and the animals and the birds would take the skin away and the meat away from the bones and leave the bones and the skulls there. When early Christians thought about a cross, they thought of something a whole lot different than we think about today. Think about this. Our way of capital punishment used to be an electric chair in many places. Now it's become an injection, a lethal injection. And you can just imagine that, on many churches, of course, in our church here, we have a cross right here. We don't have a steeple per se, but you'll see a cross as a steeple in many places. You'll see a cross throughout the buildings. Imagine us having an electric chair back here on the wall, or a hypodermic needle. I mean, it would look weird. It would look very strange. Imagine a steeple on a church being an electric chair. But see, that's the idea of what it would have been like in the first century A.D. It's ridiculous for us to really think that way, but that's the way it would. See, we look at the cross as something beautiful, but in that day, it was not a thing of beauty. Ladies, some of you have a cross around your neck this morning. Some of you may have earrings that are made of a cross. You may have a ring or something that would have a cross, and we see it all around us. Sometimes the cross is used as even a decoration in places, and you'll see that. But what do you think about when you see a cross? Your first thoughts may be nothing at all. You may not think of anything in particular even when you see a cross. When you do see it, many people say, well, I think about church, or I think about religion. Many people, when they see it, they say, well, I think of something boring. And I say, well, how sad that is to think about something like that when it's the place where the Lord Jesus Christ hung on for the sins of the world. The cross being held in low regard by many people today, and it should not be that way. See, the cross of Christ was extremely important to Paul. It was extremely important. He lived it. He preached it. He wrote about it. He gloried in it. Boy, you get the Apostle Paul to start talking a little bit. Before long, he starts talking about the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ and what that meant to him. Because to him, the cross of Christ was the power of God and the wisdom of God. I'll say to you today, in our world, however, many people are offended by the cross. And really, that's the way it's supposed to be anyhow. But they're offended to the point where they do something about it. In 2006, I read this about the president of William and Mary back in 2006, said we've got this 100-year-old 2-foot high brass cross that stood on the altar of the chapel here at William and Mary. I want it removed so as to make it welcoming to everyone. Well, it was removed for a while, but guess what? It's back now. In Brevard County, Florida, a few years ago, Palm Bay High School was planning to have its graduation ceremonies at a church there in Melbourne, Florida. And one of the graduating seniors, I don't even know how many was in the class, but I'm sure it was a good number. One of the graduating seniors, along with her father stepmother, argued that holding the public school graduation ceremony in the church facility represented an intolerable and unconstitutional establishment of religion. Because behind the pulpit on the wall, like we have here, is a cross. Well, they sued and the court ruled that there wasn't enough time for the school to find another location for the graduation, that it would be held as planned. Then somebody says, well, why don't we just cover it up? The church said, we're not covering it up. You can still have your graduation here, but we're not covering it up. And sure enough, the graduation went on just like it was planned. Well, people are offended by the cross. It is true today. It has been true through the years. But let me tell you something. What do you see? Let me ask you, what do you see when you survey the wondrous cross? Paul sees something. He says, God forbid that I should glory save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. So as we survey the cross this morning and we think about the cross, let's go to the scene. Let's look at the scene. Let's see some of the people who were around the cross and how they viewed what was going on. I'll tell you this much this morning, when we think about the cross and the scene around it and what was happening there, we see a number of different people looking at the cross and looking at it in different ways. There were some Roman soldiers around the cross. And of course, they looked upon the Lord Jesus Christ as just a common criminal, just somebody that we're here just to do our job today. They were just doing their job. But then they noticed that on the Lord Jesus Christ, his garment was very, very valuable. The only thing of value that he even owned in the world. It was very, very valuable. And they had talked about maybe cutting it up and sharing it among themselves. And then somebody said, oh no, this is too valuable to cut up. We don't want to cut it up. Let's gamble for it. And so the only thing that the Lord Jesus Christ had of any value in this world was gambled over by the Roman soldiers there. So we see the Roman soldiers saw a robe to be coveted and to be gambled over. And you know the story. We also look and we see a religious priest, not a saved person by far, but a religious person. He saw Jesus Christ as just a rabble rouser. He looked at the Lord Jesus Christ and he said, he's a blasphemer. He's worthy of death. Because John 19, 6 and 7 says, when the chief priest therefore and the officers saw him, they cried out saying, crucify him, crucify him. Pilate saith unto them, take ye him and crucify him, for I find no fault in him. The Jews answered him, we have a law, and by our law he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God. So we had religious priests who saw him as a rabble-rouser, who saw him as a blasphemer. But we know him to be truly the Son of God, just like Pilate said too, I find no fault in him. On that day that Jesus hung on that cross, there was a lot of people who came to gulp. Just like many people do today, you know, when they see an accident or see a fire or see something that happens, you know, rubberneckers, we call them. They stop to see things and to gawk at the accident scene where death and carnage abounds. Well, there were people who came just to rubberneck, just to gawk the Lord Jesus Christ, the death and the suffering that was going on. And we know from Psalms 22 that they were even like wild animals who stood around with their teeth showing, waiting for the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, to die. And they derided him, the Bible says. And by saying he saved others, let him save himself if he be the Christ, the chosen of God. They derided him and they mocked him and they scorned him. They laughed at him. I don't know a soul alive who wants anybody to laugh at them or to mock them or scorn them, but the Lord Jesus Christ had plenty of that day. He did that because of me. That's how some people saw the scene when they surveyed it. We know that there was a criminal on one side of the Lord and another criminal on another side that was crucified at the same time as he was. At first, these two criminals both had the same survey of the Lord Jesus Christ, but it wasn't long before the other one changed his mind. But the one saw the Lord Jesus Christ. When he surveyed this scene and he saw all that was going on, he looked at the Lord Jesus Christ and said, he's just another criminal being crucified. But the other man who was dying for his sin, in essence, saw the hope of heaven. And I love what the second man who was being crucified said to the other. He said, "But the other answering rebuked him, saying, Dost not thou fear God, seeing thou art in the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds, but this man hath done nothing amiss." And so there was testimony after testimony. "I find no fault in him. This man has done nothing wrong." And then this thief on the cross looked at the Lord Jesus Christ and he said, "Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom." And Jesus said unto him, "Verily I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise." You see the different people who surveyed the scene and who sees what's going on? There was another religious ruler who saw a body that had to be disposed of before the Sabbath. And in John 19:31, the Bible says, "The Jews therefore, because it was the preparation that the body should not remain upon the cross on the Sabbath day, for that Sabbath day was an high day, besought Pilate that their legs might be broken, that they might be taken away." He said, again, this is just a man who's hanging here on this cross, and we don't want him to live any longer, so we just need to start breaking legs, which they did to the others, but did not do to the Lord Jesus Christ because of prophecy. Just a criminal hanging on a cross. He needs to die. He needs to die. Joseph of Arimathea, after he had surveyed the scene, and he saw the Lord Jesus Christ dying on the cross, and then when he died, he saw a body to be lovingly laid to rest. And we know that Joseph of Arimathea, we know Nicodemus along with him, went to Pilate and begged the body of Jesus. And they got it down from the cross and went and laid it in his tomb. But it didn't stay there long, of course, we know that. We also know there was a Roman soldier that surveyed the scene, and he saw the Lord Jesus Christ die. And we saw him give up the ghost. And the Bible says in Matthew 27:54, "Now when the centurion and they that were with him watching Jesus," or surveying the scene, surveying Jesus, "saw the earthquake and those things that were done, they feared greatly, saying, Truly this was the Son of God." We know there was a lot of people who did not think he was the Son of God dying for the sins of the world, but there were some. So how do you view the cross? How do you see the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ today? When you survey it, what do you see? Well, I'll tell you, when I survey it, I'll tell you what I see. I see first and foremost my own sin. My own sin. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:21, "For he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." 1 Peter 2:24, "Who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sin should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes we are healed." And when I look at the cross, I look at the enormity and depravity of sin, and I look at my sin, the enormity and depravity of my sin. Let me tell you something, all you got to do is watch the news or read the newspaper, and you are absolutely amazed at the enormity and depravity of sin of this world. A few months ago, there was north of Atlanta, there was a man who had killed 5 or 6 people, who had buried them on some property that he had owned. And he had actually lured a man and a woman to his property. And while they were there, he killed this man. And he took the woman and he put her in a cage, chained her and bound her for months. Every day he would go and rape her. And eventually, praise the Lord, was found out. And we look at that and we say, how in the world could somebody do that to other people? How could they do it? And we see the enormity and depravity of sin, and we look at that and we say, those people are horrible. And then I have to be reminded myself that I am a sinner just like that person was. And if I got what I deserved, I would get an eternal hell. Because the Bible says that if we've sinned one time, we're guilty of all. And so when I see the cross, when I survey the cross, I see the enormity and depravity of my sin. I see the lovely, sinless Son of God who became sin for me. It says in Psalm 22 that we've been studying in the adult Sunday school class, he says, while he's on the cross, he says, I'm just a worm and no man, a reproach of men, despise of the people. All that see me laugh me to scorn. And it's because of my sin and your sin that happens. There's not a greater reminder of our sin and how serious my sin is other than the old rugged cross that Jesus Christ hung upon. I got news for you. We don't like to think about our sin, do we?
We don't want to think about it.
We don't want to talk about it. Maybe that's why we don't survey the cross very much. We don't want to think about it. We don't want to think about we're a sinner. Matter of fact, we want to evade it. We want to cover it up. We want to try to justify ourselves in everything that we do. But listen, the purpose of the Bible is to bring men to the obedience of the cross of Christ. Matter of fact, what we're doing here today, having this preaching service, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 1:18, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God.
But I see my sin. But I also see the love of God. And I see the depth of God's love.
When I survey the cross, I see my sin and the enormity and depravity of my sin. But I also see the depth of God's love. The word sin written in blood is very true. But then I see the hand of God reaching down from heaven and erasing all the writing of my sin. 1 John 3:1-3, behold what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And every man that hath this hope in him purifieth himself even as he is pure. We see the depth of God's love. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. We see the love of God. Listen, people say, well, it was the nails that held him there. No, it wasn't the nails that held him there. It was his love for you and his love for me that held him there. What do you see when you survey the cross? What do you see when you survey the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ? Let me tell you something. I see my sin. And I see the depth of the love of God. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 says, for the love of Christ constraineth us, because if we thus judge that if one died for all, then we're all dead, and that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again. Verse 16 says, wherefore henceforth know we no man after the flesh, yea, though we have known Christ after the flesh, yet now henceforth know we him no more. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. What do you see when you survey the cross of Christ? We don't think about it all that much anymore. We're so busy, so active. So much to keep up with in the world today. Do we think about the cross? What do you think about when you survey the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ? When you're reading through the Word of God and you think about it, when it's brought to your mind, or when you see a cross, maybe on a church steeple or maybe out and about or whatever, what do you think about when you see the cross? When you survey the cross of Christ, what do you think about? Do you think about your sin? Do you think about the love of God for us? Listen, when you survey it, you should think that there's a debt that's been paid in full. Aren't you thankful for that? Amen. He said, it is finished. He said, tetelestai, which means the debt has been paid in full. Boy, wouldn't you like to know in the morning you check your bank records and that loan that you got from the bank, maybe for your car or for your house or whatever,
all of a sudden it says balance zero. And you call the bank, you say, what in the world? They say, somebody's paid that debt for you. It's paid in full. You'd say, hallelujah. And then, of course, you'd say, who was that? Yeah. Let me tell you something. We had a debt that we could not pay. We had something that we owed that we could not pay, and the Lord Jesus Christ came, and he paid that debt in full. In full. Let me tell you something. When we survey the cross, sure, we should see our sin, and we should see the love of God, but we should also see that our sin debt has been paid in full. Amen. But if you're lost here this morning, I don't want to be in your shoes. What do you think about the people who nailed the Lord Jesus Christ to the cross? What do you think about the soldiers who beat him? What do you think about the soldiers who mocked him and laughed at him? What do you think about the people who came by and derided him and mocked him and scorned him, laughed at him, spit on him? Made fun of him. Would you want to be in their shoes today? If you're here and you do not know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior and you're surveying the cross along with us this morning, you need to realize that you have a need that you cannot meet. You cannot save yourself. If you're uncommitted to the Lord Jesus Christ today, then you need to hear Hebrews chapter 10, verse 26. For it says, for if we sin willfully after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sins. In other words, you have come, you know what is the truth, you know what's going on, and if you sin willfully and you reject what you have, there's no more sacrifice for you. Verse 27 says, but a certain fearful looking for of judgment and fiery indignation which shall devour the adversaries. Verse 28, he that despised Moses' law died without mercy under two or three witnesses. Verse 29, of how much sorer punishment suppose ye shall he be thought worthy who hath trodden underfoot the Son of God and hath counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he was sanctified an unholy thing and hath done despite unto the Spirit of grace. How in the world are you ever going to be able to stand before God one day without him saying, depart from me, I never knew you? Isaac Watts, 1707. He was surveying the cross. He was thinking about it. It might have been a part of his devotions for the day, I don't know. But he sat down and he wrote the words to this song. When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss, and I pour contempt on all my pride, thinking that I'm something that I can save myself or whatever it may be. I pour contempt on all my pride, he said. Then he said, forbid it, Lord, that I should boast, save in the death of Christ my God. All the vain things that charm me most, I sacrifice them to his blood. Then he said, see, look, survey it. See from his head, his hands, his feet, sorrow and love flow mingled down. He said, did e'er such love and sorrow meet? Or thorns compose so rich a crown? Were the whole realm of nature mine? He says, that were a present far, far too small. If you own the universe, it's a present far too small to give to the Lord for what he did for us on the cross. And then he closes out his song by saying, love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all. What Jesus Christ did on the cross, it demands our all, and we should want to give our all to Him for what? Because He gave His all for us. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed.